scoliosis. For scoliosis. And YouTube is not as nice as Google. YouTube said, did you mean yoga, stupid? And of course I did. So I looked up some videos now. You think going to the gym for the first time is embarrassing? Try striking a warrior pose and just tip it right over. That's why you do that in your living room when nobody can see you. So anyway, after wrecking myself, I called my buddy Jan. Janice Blinn was back there who helped me out because I was gonna kill myself is what I was gonna do if I kept going that route. She really did help me out. I said all that to say this. One, I love you and I appreciate you. And two, for you new people here, that's just how this church family rolls. Like, anytime you need something, this family is phenomenal. You need it, and I love it, just for that purpose. And if this is your first time here, I want to say welcome home. Also today, folks, something's happening today. Can anybody tell me?
No.
Here we go. Our children's ministry. They're having a fundraiser to do, you know, so many different things that we can do. They're having a fundraiser at Serenity on Friday that starts at 10 o'clock. What we're in need of is some baked goods for a bake sale. So if you can, please. See Shelly or Kim and get them some baked goods, some things that they can sell, raise some money, and get out there and do some things and grow with the Lord together. There's a lot to be done with our children. Next Sunday is our ladies' luncheon. While the ladies are having lunch, the men are going to play golf. Or we're going to go out to the golf course. I guess playing golf is a matter of opinion. After the ladies' luncheon, our very own Jordan and Hannah back there. Going to get married on October 15th. Team Jordan. She's Team Jordan. After the ladies' luncheon, they're having a wedding shower for Hannah right after next week. So please plan on being there for that as well. Small groups. Miss Grace is this Thursday at 6:30. She also has the other one start Sunday at 4 o'clock, and then the young adults will be at Steve and Tina's at Sunday at 6 o'clock. They'll provide child care here from 5:30 to 8:30. So you can come in, drop the kids off, get over there, and just fellowship together every time the Lord, and then come back and get your kids and take off. So if you want to be part of a small group, though, we haven't started, so please get plugged in. See Jen, you can raise your hand, just raise your hand all one more time. If you want to get plugged into a small group, please see Jen. She can direct you to the right one. Also, weekly announcements, 9:45, our men meeting room, we're over there for prayer. 10 o'clock is our worship service. Mondays, we have just a mass prayer request list we send out to different people in the church. So also, see Jen, raise your hand, Jen. If you have a prayer request, please get it to Jen so she can get it out to everybody that needs to get it. And then also, if you want to be part of the prayer wars, is on that list. Just get your name on that list as well. Wednesday, we'll be at 6 o'clock, and we have our service at 6:30. We still have coffee mugs available for $5. We have yard signs. They are free there. See JD. When you leave here, JD should have some in the back to put in your yard. Typically, we reserve a PM service for memberships, and we'll do that once a month. We have some folks that didn't want to wait until the next time, and we don't want them to wait, so we're going to do that right now. Morris, Carol, Wayne, if you'll stand. Body, and each member belongs to all the members. In Ephesians 4:15 and 16, it says, speaking the truth in love, we will grow, become in every respect of the mature body of Him who is the head, that is Christ. From him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself in love as each part does its work. This body is phenomenal in the way that we support each other. We're so proud that you want to join us as members into this body of Christ. This isn't Steve's church. This is our church. This is our family. We're all a part of the body of Christ. But this is our church family where we're home. We want to welcome you. Everybody's hand. Dear Christ, what we love you now. What you want to do? You want to shake your four hands, tell them good morning, you love them, welcome home. And our new members, I told y'all we forget. Bam! I got a note. Reminder. Need the last deposit for the ladies' retreat, October 2nd. That's next week. So if you're going to the ladies' retreat, you need your last deposit next week. That was perfect. Thank you. Alright, so our new members, Wayne, Morris, Carol, make sure you shake their hand and tell them welcome home. Is that right? Thank you.
stand. I'd like to ask you to stand. In God's tithes and our offerings, I got to tell you, last night I went to one of my class reunions. Just been 10 years. Tina and I went to a class reunion, and I walked in, and I'm like, hey, because you know, I just conditioned myself to just love people. That's what God just taught me to do. So I walk in, I'm like, hey, how you doing? How you doing? We got to the edge of the door. How you doing? Good seeing you. We got to the end. I told Tina, I said, these are old people. We got to go. I'm going to tell you something. Those people got old. So all I can say is bless their hearts. If you're visiting from out of state, we say bless their hearts in Tennessee, which wipes out anything bad that you say. So bless their hearts, those old people. I want to pray a prayer today over you. I want us to pray a prayer of God's blessings upon our lives financially. I want us to pray that out loud. If you're visiting with us today, we pray this prayer, and we pray it out loud over our tithes, our offerings, our efforts. And we believe that God is moving in a powerful way. If God has affected you in your financial life through this prayer, raise your hand. Hallelujah. I'm going to raise both mine. Amen. Let's pray it together. As we receive this morning's tithes and offerings, we are believing you, our Lord, for provision and protection, jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, benefits, sales and commissions, favorable settlements and contracts, interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, money found and debts paid off, expenses decreased and blessings increased. And thank you, Lord, for meeting all of my financial needs so that I may have more than enough to give into the kingdom of God and promote the gospel of Jesus Christ. And say with me right now, amen. Amen. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you, gentlemen. I want to say to you that something is happening. And I think some of us in here are getting a little bit anxious to find out what's happening. We're going to talk about that in a little bit. Something's happening. And God is on the move. God is up to something. I'm excited to be a part of it. So God is wide open. Things are changing. Things are changing at Christpoint Church. And I just want you guys to be a part of it. Amen, 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 amen. Thank you for worshiping with us in God's tithes and our offerings. Thank you. Yeah.
Your presence, Lord, Last night at the class reunion.
Steve won't come up here to sing karaoke because in their mind, Steve will do anything. That's the way I left them. Steve will do it. Steve will come up here and sing karaoke, and I said, I don't know how to do that. But if you'll give me a little while and I get a worship team over here, then I can sing off key with them real well. So they're like, we don't want to do all that. I'm like, well, I'm not playing then. You don't play the way I want to play, I'm not playing. Something's happening at Christpoint Church. Something's happening. And I am going to tell you what's happening, but first of all, let's go to 2 Kings. Let's go to 2 Kings chapter 4, verses 1 through 7. Good stuff, good stuff. Take this home, read it, and study on it, and let it rightfully divide in your hearts. Now the wife of one of the sons of the prophets cried to Elisha, "Your servant, my husband, the son of the prophet, is dead." She's telling him, "Now I'm a widow. I'm crying out to you, Elisha, the man of God, and you know that your servant feared the Lord. But God, but the creditor, we owe for our land, we owe for our home, we owe for medical expenses, who knows? But the creditor has come to take my two children to be his slaves." And Elisha said to her, "What shall I do for you? Tell me, what have you got in the house?" And she said, "Your servant has nothing in the house except a jar of oil. That's all he got." Then he said, "Go outside, borrow vessels from all your neighbors, empty vessels, and not too few." Let me back up real quick, Gwen, if you want to care back up. I think this is my favorite part of everything that we're going to talk about this morning. Go out and get those vessels and make sure it's not too few. Make sure you don't limit what God can do. And make sure you don't go get one and come back. Let's go on. I'm going to get on that in a minute. Then go in and shut the door behind yourself and your sons and pour it into all these vessels. And when one is full, set it aside. Set it aside. Just keep on going. So she went in from him and shut the door behind herself and her sons. And she poured and they brought the vessels to her. When the vessels were full, she said to her son, "Bring me another vessel." And he said to her, "There's not another. We're out. We're done." Then the oil stopped flowing. She came and told the man of God, being Elisha, and he said, "Go and sell the oil, pay your debts, and you and your sons can live on the rest." Thank you, Lord, for your anointing.
Hallelujah.
Thank you for your blessings. I thank you. I thank you. I thank you. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. This lady has got something going on in her life that I call the D factor. She's got a heavy load of despair, death, debt, and devotion. She's got the D factor going on. She's got a death in her family. She's got debt in her family. She's got death in her despair in her family and devotion. Let me talk a little bit about that. Sometimes we find ourselves just simply in a dark place. I've been in a dark place. I've been in a dark place mentally before. I don't know which is worse, physically or mentally. I've been in a dark place mentally to where I didn't really know where I was going or where I was going to end up. I've talked about that in here. Tina and I were in a place to where we just kept going no matter what. But sometimes we just find ourselves in dark places, and I would love to be able to say to you, that's never going to happen, but I can't. We're not exempt. Despair. We find ourselves in a place of despair due to our circumstances sometimes. We may have to deal with the death of a loved one. Some of our folks in here are dealing with that right now. Some are dealing with that. They're still trying to find a new normal. When you've lived with somebody for all those many years, then I tell mothers and fathers and husbands and wives, I'm like, now, God, nothing's ever going to be the same. You just got to try to find a new normal. My life's not normal anymore. It's not like it was for 20, 30, 40 years. I got to find a new normal. So they're dealing with death. We're dealing with despair. There may be a constant stream of debt. These things may go hand in hand. We were accustomed to paying our bills on two incomes. Now I'm by myself. Now I don't have the other half or better or worse, I don't know, of the income. And now I can't make ends meet. I am in debt. I am in trouble. I have a debt issue. But like this woman, we have to search. We've got to search deep inside. And we've got to find our devotion. This woman was in a bad place. She was in a desperate place. She was in a place of despair. She was in a place where she had just experienced recently death. She was in a place of debt. But you know what she said? I believe in what God is doing. I believe in the man of God. I didn't run out and ask friends. I didn't run out and talk about anything else. But I went straight to the man of God and I said, "What can I do? Help me. You are the man of God." I love the way she had a strong sense of devotion. But let me explain something to you. We cannot make God move. We just can't. We can't make God move. We can't stomp, pitch a fit. We can't throw a fit. We can't hold our breath like the Andy Griffith thing we watched the other night when the little boy held his breath to get his way with his dad and hope he tried it. And Andy says, "What are you doing?" "Oh, my breath will stop it before you fall over." I picture God being that way. I'm not going to move just because you pitch a fit. I'm not going to work that way. We can't manipulate the presence of God. Now think about this one. When we manipulate the presence of God, we are taking our lives and putting them into a very dangerous place. Our hearts and our spirits into a very dangerous place by saying, "God said," or "I want to pull God into the situation, mention His name so I can get what I want." God's not going to be manipulated. God is smarter than He's bigger than that. He's altogether in working in our situation, and we don't need to help Him. But what we can do is we can make room for Him to move. We can make room for God to move. We can't manipulate Him, we can't make Him, but we can make room for Him to move. Keep that in mind. Let's take a look at some key elements. In the story that we just read, let's take a look at some key elements. Let's see some, let's look at some things that's going on. The word says there, very first, says He asked her, "What do you have?" He being Elisha. She says, "I am in a state of despair. I am in a state of desperation. I am in a state of death. I am in a state of debt and devotion. What can you have? What do you have? What do you have? Tell me, lady. Tell me, Miss Widow. What do you have to bring to the table?" Let's always let's look at ourselves and what God is saying. What do I have to bring to the table? What does Christpoint Church have to bring to the table? What do you have? Tell me, what do you have? What do I have that's of any value to the Lord? "Well, you know, I've got some money." You know, God's like, that's not a value to me. "How much do you need?" "Well, I need $52,000. "Well, okay, put that right back up. God's not interested in what money. He's got more than that. You can't entice God by money. It's not going to work. So you can't say, I have all of this. I have status. I have influence. I have this. I have that." No, God says, "What do you have that's of value to me that you can bring to the table?" I sat down with some businessmen 20 years ago. One said, "I can bring to the table the marketing." One said, "I can bring to the table the money." And I said, "I can bring to the table the experience." So we looked at what we talked about doing, and we said, if one of us can't bring something to the table, then that one is really don't even need to be there. "What do you have to bring to the table?" this man is saying. She says, "I got a jar of oil. That's what I have. There's nothing in my house," which tells me she's probably sold everything that she's had. She's probably got to the point to where there's nothing left and the old Buick's broken down. "There's nothing that I have that's going to work. I've got a jar of oil." Can you imagine going into the house and rummaging around and saying, "What do you have? Bring to the table what you have." And all you can find is a jar of oil? This woman was in bad shape. In other words, "I want you to bring to me what you have." Right. God's not see here, this is what we're wanting God to do in our society today. I want God to write a check. This man was saying, Elijah was saying, I'm not helping you any if I just miraculously give you everything. If I just write you a check, I'm going to engage you in what God is doing. I'm going to bring you in. So what do you have? I have a jar of oil. That's what I have. Let me explain to you what oil represents. It represents life. It represents commerce. It represents security. Oil was made by process. Think about this. Oil comes into being through a process. It goes through, the olive goes through a growth time on the tree. It goes through seasons on the tree. It gets to a ripe state. It is put into, it is harvested, then placed into a press, and extracting the juices from the olive. Then they get an oil from the olive. Most of all of the scriptures in the Old Testament refer to olive oil. So all of this goes through a process. God takes us through a process in our lives. He gets us from day one, and I've explained this. Morrison, Carol and I were talking about this just the other day. You take a bucket. Your life is a bucket of junk. Picture it as a 5-gallon bucket full of junk, and you say, Lord, I'm going to come to you when I get this all figured out. That's nonsense, or what they would say across the pond, that's poppycock. You don't fix yourself. That's not how it works. I was dumb enough to think that back 30 years ago, that I had to fix myself. I got to get the bucket cleaned out before I come to the Lord. God says, bring your bucket. Bring the bucket full of addictions. Bring the bucket full of warts. Bring the bucket full of ugliness. Bring the bucket full of attitude and anger. Bring the bucket full of old past stuff. Bring the bucket full of old girlfriends, but don't let your wife see it. Bring the bucket full of junk. Bring your past, and what we're going to do is I picture the Lord dumping it out. And the Lord sifts through it and says, now this is what we're going to deal with now. This goes back in the bucket to deal with later. I'm going to, and you know, God would just look at us and say, I can deal with all of it right now. But I'm going to deal with what you can deal with first. So He takes us through a process. And we become refined. And that oil becomes very, very needed. And it becomes very, very pertinent for our times and where we are in our lives. Olive trees took many, many years to grow. Many years to mature. I kind of think of the olive tree like the pecan tree in the South. A friend of mine planted a pecan tree over probably 25 years ago now. And he said, you know, that tree has never matured and had one bit of fruit on it since. He said, they grow so slow that it takes years to produce fruit. That's why pecans may cost so much. But olive trees lived for hundreds of years. So a good supply of olive oil, a good supply of oil was a sign of prosperity. It was a sign of stability. And a lack of oil was considered a curse by God. This lady had everything gone from her and ripped away from her, but she didn't have a curse on her life. She had the oil. She still, this is all I have. This is everything that I had. Oil was used for consumption. It was used to put into lamps because they couldn't turn a switch on. In Bible times, the times of antiquity, they couldn't flip a switch like we do now thanks to some modern day amenities. They couldn't do that. So oil literally provided vision during dark times. Think about that when you're in a dark place. Think about that when you're trying to get through it. Remember that oil is what illuminates your path and gives you the vision to move forward. It illuminates the vision. Oil was good for the skin as an ointment, good for healing. But most importantly, oil represents the anointing. Think about that. It represents the anointing. Now, if we take God's anointing out of what we're doing at Christ Point Church, we have a nice civil organization. We have a nice gathering. You know what? We have a social gathering that we have. If we take the anointing away, then we just might as well just put a different name on the building and come together and just shake hands and have a good time. But that's not what we do. We move in and through and under the anointing that God provides. The number two thing I want you to notice in this story is he told her, I want you to go outside. Now think about that. I want you to go outside, the word says. I want you to go out. I want you to go out. I want you to move from where you are. I want you to go out and go forth and bring them in. I want you to go out there and I want you to bring vessels in. See, people are vessels. Go out there. They need to be filled with the Lord. They need to be full. You're responsible. Your job, widow lady Steve, whoever's in here, your job is to go out. You can't do it in here. You've got to go alone. You've got to go out. Go out because that's where the vessels are. Go out. And number three, he told her, gather vessels. Go to your neighbors. Go to your friends. And I love what he said, and not too few. Right. If we were saying that today, we'd say, go out and get as many as you possibly can. And then when you think you've got all that you can give, go knock on doors and get more. Get as many as you possibly can to get those vessels filled, because I'm going to fill them up. I am convinced that this woman knew that those vessels were going to be filled. I'm convinced people are vessels. Go out, go forth, bring them in, and don't stop at one. Don't stop at a few. Don't limit the outpouring. Don't limit, because God is going to, the outpouring will stop as quick as we, just as quick as we say, we're done, we're full, we don't want anymore. That's when God stops. When in our lives, if you say, God, I've got enough of you, I don't want anymore, we'll stop. Very, very gentlemanlike. I'm not going to pour into you any more than what you want. So when we say, God, pour into me, bring me your empty vessels. Be a broken vessel before me so I can just keep pouring and keep pouring and keep pouring. Don't just look for the ones that can hold the most. Don't just go out and look for the ones that fit the bill. In other words, people are vessels. And when I go out that door, I can't be looking for the ones that I think make good church people. Because I have got to go back to the story of me. I was not one that looked like a good church person. I was not that person. I didn't look like the good church person. And today, if you line 100 preachers up, you'll be able to pick out which one's me if we have bags overhead. I'll be the one in flip-flops and shorts. I promise you. I will be the one that and I'll be probably darker than most of them. But the thing is, is I will look different, and I don't care. That's what God's put in me. That's how we roll around Christpoint Church. Amen. Don't just look for the ones that hold the most. I'm going to go out, and I'm going to gather up every big vessel that I can find and ignore the little ones. That's not what the scripture says. I'm convinced that they went out and they looked for every pot. They knocked on every door. They went and borrowed from everybody that they could come in contact with. I need your basins. I need your vases. I need your cups. I need your buckets. And do you have any spoons in the house? Because they'll hold something. If I line all the spoons up, I mean, I'm telling you, we have got to keep on giving me something as long as the pouring is happening. I want to keep getting it filled. I don't want to stop. Number four, the oil continued to flow as long as the vessels were being filled. Think about that. As long as the vessels are being filled, the oil will continue to flow. As long as there are vessels that say, Lord, pour into me. And I look around the United States of America and I wonder how many of our people, how many of our citizens, how many of our churches are saying, Lord, keep pouring. Keep pouring with everything that you have. Keep pouring. I need you to pour into me. God will pour as long as we provide the vessels. As long as we make room. Number five, this lady was required to do the pouring. I want you to notice with me. He said, you go inside. I'm going to stay out here. I'm going to stay out here. You go inside and you do the pouring. She goes in. She gets all the vessels inside, pots, all kinds of stuff, and she starts pouring, and her sons are just bringing container after container, and she's pouring, and she's like, I don't know where this stuff's coming from, but it sure is coming. Let's just keep on and keep on and keep on. She was required to do the pouring, and God, it was His responsibility to keep the oil lively, to keep the oil abundant. It was the widow that had to pour it. It's our job to do the pouring.
Right.
It's our job to do the work. It's our job to say, hey, what's going on in your life? How's everything in your life? Do you need me to pray with you? Because let me tell you something, it takes time. It's easy to say, I'm going to pretend like they're not there because I've got to rock and roll. I've got to get out of here. I'm going to pretend like they're not there in need. I'm going to pretend like they're not reaching out. Somebody's like, I need God to move in my life financially. I'll tell you what, it'd be easier for me to write a check than it would be to sit here with you. But see, that's not what people need. People need somebody to sit down with them and put their arms around them and say, you know what? I'm going to pray because we've got an endless source of income in our Father. And I'm going to pray because I'm going to get you plugged into Him. I'm going to get you to the source of the oil. I'm going to get you to the place where it don't stop flowing. That's what I'm going to do. If I write you a check, I'll write you one more. It was her responsibility to pour. God provided, but we keep bringing the vessels to be filled. It's our job to provide the space. God provides the anointing. He fills the vessels that we prepare for Him, and the only limitations in this entire scenario lies in us. That's the only limitations. I want to tell you, there is nothing, that oil would have still been flowing right now if there had still been vessels available in the house. God just has a way of doing things that we can't understand. That's how He does things. Worship team, if you would come. I want to ask you a question. What would you be willing to give? That's my question. What would you be willing to give to see someone's life changed? What would you be willing to give? Like I said, would you be willing to give of your resources? Because I want to tell you something. It takes 3 minutes to get in your pocket and get $5 out. It takes 3 minutes to write a check. It takes maybe months to get into someone's life. What would we be willing to give of our resources? I was asked before a review committee going for my bishop's license, said, what is your passion? I said, seeing people's lives changed. I said, I love preaching the gospel. Who don't? Well, preacher don't. But I love to see people's lives change. I love to look at my best friend and my son, JD. And I love to see where we came from together and where God has brought us together. That's what I like to see. That's what I like to see, people's lives change. Would we be willing to give of our resources to see lives change? Would we be willing to give of our time? More precious of a commodity these days. Would we be willing to give of our time? That's a big one. Would we be willing to give love to the unlovable folks in our lives? The unlovable ones that we would... I want to tell you, you are kidding yourself if you can say in this room, oh, I don't have any... I love everybody. I just like everybody. That's not true. I've got people in my life I don't even like. I'm commanded by God to love them, but I'd rather be somewhere else and them in another room somewhere else. But you know what? That's the way it is. We're all different. God, are you willing to take God and His plan of salvation to people that are unlovable? Are we willing to do that? When we give what we have, like that widow woman did? Would we give what we have? Would we give what cost us absolutely nothing? But amounts to everything? Would we give what costs nothing but amounts to everything? Would we limit ourselves and would we limit God? Would we be willing to give something precious like space? Would we be willing to give where we sit? Would we be willing to give our place at the table? Jeff and Peggy, would you be willing to give somebody your seat to see their life change? Would you stand against that wall? Josh, would you guys be willing to give your seat to see someone's life change? Would you, Johnny? Would you guys stand against the wall? Pastor Carrie Curry and Ivy, would you guys be willing to give your seat to see somebody's life change? I know you would. Would you stand against that wall? And I know this girl would. You would be willing to give your seat. And I know Travis and I know Heather would. Would you guys stand against the wall? Please do that. Steve and Susan, would you be willing to give your seat away to somebody else? Michael, my big buddy, would you be willing to give your seat to somebody else? Keith, would you? Karen, I know you would. John, would you would? Those people stay right there. We're going to let you move. You guys, would you be willing to give your seat to see somebody? Would you stand against the wall? Maybe you would, wouldn't you? JD, I know you would. I know Buddy and Dorothy would. Would you guys stand against the wall? Where's our back row crew? Would you guys stand up and give your seat to somebody else? Would you just get against the wall? Morris, God, would you do that? Would you guys do that? Would you give your seat to see somebody, to see their life change? Let me tell you what we just did in this room. We created a vessel. We created room. We made space. We just made space. We just made space. Let me tell you, we created a vessel. Something is going on, and it's happening on October 30th. On October 30th, Christpoint Church is going to two morning services. To know the Lord. Because let me tell you something, the worst thing in my life, one of the worst things would be if somebody got to that door out there and couldn't get their paralyzed friend in. They couldn't get through the doors because there's too many people. I love having too many people. I love the problems that we have in our life. But we've got to make space. We've got to make space. So I'm asking you, my church family, make space. Go out and go forth and bring people in and let them know that you are a vessel for the finer. You are a vessel that I want the Lord to pour into, and I need you with me in my church. I need you to stand beside me in the kingdom. I want you to hide yourself in the shadow of the cross like I have my family. I want them to know that we care about them, that their lives are important, and you may be going through dark time, but I'm giving you two options. You tell your friends, I'm giving you two options. If you are an early riser, at 9 o'clock we will have worship service. If you can't get kids put together and you can't get pretty clothes on, then 11 o'clock works, man. Let's get out of here. So I want to ask you, are you on board? Thank you. on YouTube on Wednesday together. But after October 30th, they'll be attending one and they'll be serving one. That's how God does it. I'm going to attend one, I'm going to serve one, I'm going to pick one, I'm going to be a part of the fastest growing church in White County in Upper Covenant, and I'm going to get a part of the most anointed place where God is moving, and He is boss, and He is pastor, and He is everything, and we get right at the foot of the cross. So I want to ask you, do me a favor, bow your heads and close your eyes. I'm not going to leave here without opening vessels. I'm not going to leave here without getting into our hearts and our minds. Something is happening, and it's not just happening at 9-11. It's happening in our hearts. So I want to ask you, is your heart an open vessel for the Lord? Are you willing to serve the Lord? Do you have a relationship with Jesus Christ? Do you have that working relationship? Not that I have a Jesus suit that I put on, but do you have a relationship with Jesus Christ? If you want to do that, then we're going to pray a prayer. We're going to work as a team. We're going to pray the prayer as a team. We're going to pray it out loud. And we're going to ask God to move in our hearts and our minds and forgive us of our sins. I want you to pray with me right now, loud as you can. Everybody, because see, here's what we roll. The guy or the woman sitting next to you may have been serving the Lord for 50 years or 50 minutes, but we're going to pray it out loud. And we're going to say, I'm helping my neighbor. We work as a team at Christpoint Church. Pray it with me right now. Dear Jesus, I come before you. An empty vessel. Break me and pour into me. I ask you to forgive me of my sins according to your word. I ask you to bless my life. And I ask you, Jesus, for a renewed spirit. I thank you, Lord, for what you've just done. I thank you for the victory. Church. I thank you for my family. And I thank you, Lord, most of all, for being my Savior. In your name I pray. Amen, amen, amen. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed, who prayed that prayer for the first time? Who prayed that prayer? There's two, there's three. Amen, amen, amen. Is there anybody else that said, I prayed that prayer and I meant it? God's forgiven me of my sins. Let me tell you, the Word tells us that whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in our heart that God raised Him from the dead, then that person shall be saved. That's what the Word says. So now I want to take a minute and I want to open the altar. I want to give you an opportunity to seek the Lord. I want to give you an opportunity to hunger for righteousness. I want to give you an opportunity to say, Lord, I need you in my life. I need a restoration. I need a renewal. I need a regeneration. I need something. I just need to pray for thanksgiving and nothing else. The altars are open. This is your church. This is your altars. This is what God anoints us as a place of victory. I invite you to come as we sing.
Yeah.
pick which one you want. We got you 9, we got you 11 for now. That's for now. And when we fill up, we'll do something again. God is moving in a powerful way. Sanctuary, our lives, Lord. In your name we pray, Jesus. Amen and amen.